Hi, welcome. I welcome you all, cinephiles, filmmakers, organizers, and friends. I welcome you all. So let me introduce myself. Today I'm going to be your host. I'm Lakshmikant. I'm an independent filmmaker, and I'm academically trained in Hindustani classical music and ethnomusicology. That's my subject, and now I make films. Today's subject is very interesting, and we have got a very, very interesting panel. The subject is digital, the democratizing force. Thankfully, we have very, very interesting panelists who have worked in these exact areas. Gaurav of Cinemapreneur, Pratik of White Wall Screenings, Nidhi of RCVJ, Shikha of the Red Sparrow, and Nachi Guspetia of Potato Eaters. Welcome all panelists. So first I want to talk to Gaurav. And Gaurav, tell me about Cinemapreneur and what is the idea, how it came to be.
Right. Thanks a lot, Lakshmikant. I think it's a very interesting state of affairs we are in, which is basically that now through technology, a lot of things have got democratized. So, you know, whether YouTube came and allowed all of us to create content, whether digital cameras allowed us to shoot content. Now there is a next third wave of, distribution. So there is democratization in the distribution, format. Personally, Cinemapreneur is my own journey in the startup space. I was running a company by the name of Film Booth, and I started Short Film Festival way back in 2008. So I did a lot of film festivals, and I wanted to be like an entrepreneur in the cinema space, but I couldn't identify myself and create a nomenclature. And I coined the term Cinemapreneur, saying that yes, we can also have a lot of, apart from creators and filmmakers and other professionals, can we not also have people who run companies and media entities in the cinema space? And I think the idea of Cinemapreneur, what it is right now, came from the fact that I met around 50 to 100 filmmakers over a span of last 3 years, and while I was attending their films or meeting them at film festival or screening their films, I realized that the distribution democratization hasn't happened till now. And what is there is traditional forms of either theatrical distribution or the OTT distribution, and that too is not allowing a lot of independent creators to come out and lead the way. Though their storytelling is really amazing, however, the old forms of models do not allow them. So I think Cinemapreneur is an answer to that. It's a new bridge between theatrical and OTT. Where we work with filmmakers and distribute their films in a digital theater concept, where people buy films and watch films. So that's the core idea of Cinemapreneur, and it's a pay-per-view model. How we pay for content in a theatrical physical space, it's a digitization of the same.
Pay-per-view model. It's quite interesting because it deviates from your usual subscription model of even movie or your Netflix and such platforms, and it also means that the directors and people who are actually want to present films can push it to a very specific targets instead of a subscription model where you're given an entire platform. Here it is little concentrated. Can you talk about why did you choose this?
Yeah. So I'll give you a quick example. What a subscription platform is, what we have like a buffet food system. So you pay an amount and you can eat whatever you want to eat. But still there are restaurants who do a la carte, right? So still you want to eat something, pay for it and enjoy your meal according to your taste, according to your likings, according to your behavior. And different people enjoy different things. So while the buffet system works well for lot of people at large, the a la carte works very well for unique people with choices and tastes which are developed, where the user is aware. So I think that's like how we differentiate. But why we've set up a pay-per-view mechanism is that the filmmakers in cinemapreneur model work as a core part of distribution, where unlike a typical traditional OTT platform, it's not a acquisition or a immediate deal. More of that, filmmakers themselves are at the front end of distribution, because they know their communities, they know their audiences, and they are masters of what they have created. So they know their content very well. Yeah. And we built it in a manner where the filmmakers also takes charge of distributing the film. And how pay-per-view works is basically, we wanted the filmmakers to be a joint owner, so that if the film goes out to a large number of people, they win in the end. So the model has been kept to ensure that both the platform and the filmmakers win together.
That's really, really exciting and nice, beautiful way to look at it. And talk about acquisition of films. How do you do it? So, for example, I heard this Jahanabi, which was distributed by Amazon and other platforms outside India. But when it came to India, they were not really keen on it. They were like, yeah, this is too artsy for the Indian audience.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
How did you dealt with it?
Yeah. So see, when we were creating the concept of Cinemapreneur, I mean, I was going to all film festivals and I saw that a lot of people, at MAMI, at IFFI, at Dharamshala are, thronging the auditorium to watch these films. However, post the festival, there isn't a platform which is allowing these films to be showcased, right? So I think how we define artsy, art house, is just our definition of content. But what we felt is that, why do we create these labels and why these films are still not accessible in India? And I think Cinemapreneur was an outcome of my assessment that a lot of amazing films could never reach out to the people after the festival, right? Mm-hmm. And in the current pandemic and, post-COVID world, we even don't know when physical screening would be a normal, thing. So I think the whole fact that Jahnavi worked beautifully well for us is that, Anirban is a great filmmaker, and the way this film is, it's not a very typical traditional film. It's a very poetic film with less dialogues, and any traditional formats would not look at it because they have a different mandate. However, with Cinemapreneur, I think the idea worked very well with the filmmaker, where, the filmmaker also wants to reach out to an audience. And I think it was a great fit for us because we want to bring out more, rooted stories, more different stories. I think we feel that India is too varied, India is too large to be defined in typical, 5-6 formula-based films or web series. So I think we are a very, very big country, and I think we should encourage more storytelling and more varied films. And I think Anirban's Jahnavi is like a rare film which you will not find. You can't categorize it with any other film currently being played on different OTTs.
Even my film is in pipeline, and it is also very poetic, and it has very less dialogue. So I was very attracted to, I wanted to talk about this particular example, because I think a lot of filmmakers would relate to me on this this thing. And one last and like really quick one, I want to ask you something, which is, how does the economics of this work, and how is it viable?
Right. So what happens, Lakshmikant, is that, as I told you, the filmmakers are a core part of the whole process, which means that they get a lion's share of every pay-per-view. So imagine in a traditional theatrical system, the producers get between, say, 35% to 48% of, price, from a 100 rupee ticket. I think we are definitely paying much more than that. And it's because we do not have typical real estate and other costs. It works very well because the costs are limited, and you know where you're spending in the digital world because you know where it's going. And because it's directly correlated, I think the more invested and excited filmmakers do much better than filmmakers who are not very much engaged in the distribution process.
I would want to talk to now to Prateek and idea of Vaikwal screenings and how it how it works and how what was the spark behind it.
Hi, Lakshmikant. First of all, thanks to you and Whiteboard Trails for having me over. It was lovely listening to Gaurav. Whiteboard screening, see, I'm at the other side of what Gaurav just spoke, right? I'm a filmmaker myself, I'm an actor myself. So I made this short film in 2015-16, I guess, which was a part of an anthology by Hamara Movie. It went on to release in cinemas, and you know, next week Dangal and La La Land came, so we were out of cinemas. So I was looking for places in Bombay where I can actually go and screen my short film and see if, you know, see how the audiences are reacting to it, where, you know, there are 30, 40, 50 people in the audience. So that is one experience that I was missing online, though I have several short films which are online, and, you know, they reach much wider audiences. And most of my films have done like more than a few hundred views, a few hundred thousand views, definitely more than, you know, anything that would reach in a cinema. But what happens is, you know, पुराने ज़माने में ना, मतलब पुराना ज़माना के 90s में, filmmakers जाते थे auditorium में, JT Galaxy, Chandan, to see how the audience is responding to the film. So right, that experience right. You miss on the online space, right? So that is when I, you know, I was doing some theater at Habitat Cafe, and I happened to know Balraj, and that's when I pitched this idea to him. Yaar, I went to him with my film. Yaar, मुझे मेरी film screen करनी है, क्या करे बताओ. So he said, एक film screen करके क्या कर लोगे? And that's how we said, okay, let's do it for a few months and let's see how it goes. And then, you know, it all of a sudden became a Sunday activity to do. Sunday 3:30, 4 o'clock, you are headed to Habitat almost every other weekend. And you're meeting other filmmakers, you are discussing films, you're learning from other filmmakers' experiences. So that's how Vaikuvar Screenings took shape. And then with the core of short films, then we started doing independent feature films. We started doing master classes, workshops, everything. So the idea was very simple. You know, you don't make, like Gaurav said, you don't make a film and it's not over there. And for a filmmaker, it's very important to experience and learn from how the film is being received by the audience. And that will happen only when, you know, you watch the film with the audience, you know whether they are laughing at the correct point or correct point pe, oh, kya hua, ye nikal raha hai, nahi nikal raha hai, kya ho raha hai. So that is very important, and that is very transparent. You can't stage it, right?
Correct.
It's like theater. So that that led to what we call Vaikuvar Screenings today.
So what was the trigger? And obviously the trigger is COVID. But what was the idea behind going digital? And because you had to, you were forced to do it to get digital.
Yeah. See, I am a very offline kind of a person. You know, I. मेरे फ्रेंड्स को भी ये पता है मेरी आदत है, मैं चैट नहीं करता ज्यादा, मैं फोन उठा के बात करता हूँ या मैं मिलने चला जाता हूँ. आई लाइक टू बी दैट वे. बट यू नो, वी वर प्लानिंग अ फेस्टिवल, वी वर प्लानिंग अ 3-day फेस्टिवल टुवर्ड्स द एंड ऑफ मार्च, आई थिंक 2021-22 मार्च. और उसके एक हफ्ते पहले, यू नो, दिस कोविड थिंग बिकेम ऑल ऑफ अ सडन वेरी बर्निंग टॉपिक, एंड यू नो, पीपल वर रिलक्टेंट टू कम, एंड यू नो, वी वर ऑल्सो नॉट श्योर, एंड वी कॉल्ड इट ऑफ लाइक 1 week बिफोर the event. Gaurav was also supposed to be there for our event, actually. And then, of course, 22nd March is a historical day. Janta curfew hua tha, corona chale jane wala tha, lekin wo hua hai. So that is what led us to go digital, because we said, ye abhi jo aane wala time hai, this is the best opportunity for us to have conversations regarding cinema, which we ideally wouldn't have in an offline space. Because imagine calling a sound designer in an offline space. इनके तीन जन भी नहीं आएंगे उसको सुनने. But online में ये flexibility है कि people can listen to him or her whenever they want and wherever they want. So even if you're watching a live stream and if you have a meeting you have to go into, you can always, you know, it will be posted somewhere. You can go and look at it again and listen to it again. So we did a lot of quarantine and chill with Filmbox sessions online. And the idea was just to share as much knowledge right from sound design, cinematography, acting, direction, filmmaking, film distribution, film promos, you know, all those points that you miss out on otherwise, you know, and people wouldn't, if I hold an offline event, people probably wouldn't come to attend it, you know, because that's when you need names to get 100 people inside your auditorium.
Correct. So that brings to my question. And you have certain sessions with Meenakshi Shedde, Namrata Joshi, Abhishek Pandey. Such people have been associated. how was it? How do you approach such good people? And how do you actually approach your audiences? How do you bring them together?
See, approaching depends on a lot of factors. You know, even Whitebird Trails is doing a very similar thing. You reach out to people whom you want to associate with. So in our case, we did a session with Diptida Kuna, and you know, then that session Meenakshi had seen, and then she wrote to us a certain things, you know, about the session. So at that point, we said, why not have her also, because you know, she's also vastly experienced.
Correct.
And then one thing led to another. So there is no fixed way. Sometimes you, like Abhishek is a theatre friend. So Abhishek had acted in my short film, which I just told you about, which was released in cinemas. And I know his passion for, you know, voicing and all. And he has his own studio. So Abhishek, it was easy to approach because I knew him already. And the others, you know, Namrata also, like, I wanted to do something on film criticism. So then I was routed to Alka Sani, then Alka put me in touch with Namrata, and that's how it happened. And we have had a lovely panel. And you know what, during these times, I think people also have been far more forthcoming in terms of, you know, doing interaction, workshops, Insta-lives, because, you know, people want to share knowledge, but sometimes they're too occupied in other things. And, you know, if they have to reach a place and they have to travel, and Bombay mein traffic hota hai, bahut plan karna padta hai. So this is much, much easier that, you know, sitting in your living room or in your room, you can connect with somebody else and have a conversation. So that is how it works.
I'll come back to you in some time. While I'll take up Nidhi. Hi Nidhi.
Hi.
So tell me, introduce yourself and about RCBJ and the work that you do.
All right, I'm sorry to just correct you. It's
actually
RCBJ.
You don't need an introduction. I know you're quite famous, but still, for the formality's sake, we would like that.
No, I'm definitely not that famous, and it's a delight to, you know, be a part of this awesome discussion. Jahan pe, first of all, I would like to take a moment and just want to appreciate you guys for coming up with such cool names of your brands. Like, कहाँ से आई इतने अच्छे अच्छे आइडियाज, और सच में बहुत अच्छे अच्छे नाम है, पोटेटो ईटर से लेकर सिनेमा प्रोनोर और रेड स्पैरो. आई मीन इट्स ग्रेट. वाइट बर्ड ट्रेल, इट्स ऑल ग्रेट. कमिंग बैक टू मी, आई एम अ रेडियो जॉकी टर्न कॉन्टेंट क्रिएटर, और मैंने 7 साल 6 साल रेडियो किया है, और रेड एफ एम में थी मैं, और उसकी एक अलग जर्नी रही है. लेकिन वो जो ट्रांजिशन रहा है, वो रियलाइजेशन जो रहा है कि अभी बहुत मतलब सुनाई दे दिया, अब दिखाई देना है बेसिकली. सो वो रियलाइजेशन भी रेडियो जर्नी में ही हुआ, वो साथ साथ ही हो रहा था. क्योंकि एक टाइम आया जब एवरीथिंग वाज गोइंग डिजिटल, देयर वाज दिस बूम, देयर वाज दिस रेवोल्यूशन, कि एवरीबॉडी वाज यू नो मेकिंग वीडियोस. और मुझे ऐसा लगा कि 3 घंटे का शो करने से ज्यादा मैं वीडियोस बनाना एंजॉय कर रही हूँ. जैसे ही 3 घंटे का शो होता है, मुझे ऐसा लगता है दैट्स अ टास्क. लाइक देयर केम अ टाइम इन माई लाइफ जब मुझे रियलाइजेशन हुआ कि वीडियो बनाने के लिए मैं काफी एक्साइटेड हो जाती हूँ कंपेयर टू मेरे रेडियो शो के उसमें. देन आई रियलाइज कि आई शुड डू दिस फुल टाइम. तो फिर धीरे धीरे रियलाइज हुआ कि डिजिटल क्रिएटर इज अ थिंग, यू नो, कॉन्टेंट क्रिएटर इज अ थिंग. सो आई थॉट ऑफ, यू नो, अलाहाबाद और लखनऊ में इतने साल काम करने के बाद मुझे लगा अल्टीमेटली मुंबई ही जाना है, तो लेट्स गिव इट अ शॉट. And there मेरी RVCJ journey start हुई. और रजनीकांत versus CID jokes, I think pretty much हम सब teenagers थे और हमने ये नाम सुना हुआ है, रजनीकांत versus CID jokes. उस time पे बहुत नया नया Facebook की excitement थी, और उस time पे jokes वहां से meme पढ़ लेना, meme को पढ़ के खुश हो जाते थे. आज तो हम meme देख रहे हैं और उसका video देख रहे हैं, static meme देख रहे हैं. We are literally living on memes now. और अगर एक you know, एक स्थापनाकार जिसे बोला जाए तो RVCJ is the one जिसने इस चीज की एक इंडिया में शुरुआत की. और आज की डेट में 34 million से भी ज्यादा फैंस हैं RVCJ के ऑल अक्रॉस इंडिया, और ये सबसे बड़ा डिजिटल मीडिया प्लेटफॉर्म है जहाँ पे 100 से भी ज्यादा प्लेटफॉर्म इन्होंने अपने, यू नो, इंट्रोड्यूस किए हुए हैं अलग अलग लैंग्वेज के फॉर्मेट में, अलग अलग यू नो प्लेटफॉर्म के जरिए. दे आर जस्ट कनेक्टेड टू देयर ऑडियंस, एंड द ऑडियंस ऑल्सो हैव शावर्ड अस विद सो मच ऑफ लव कि मतलब वो टाइम था जब वो मीम पढ़ते थे और अब वो टाइम है जब मीम देखते हैं, उसे रिलेट करते हैं, अपने दोस्तों को टैग करते हैं. वी हैव कम अ लॉन्ग वे एंड आई थिंक वो जो ट्रेंड्स ऑफ चेंज आया है उससे RVCJ भी लगातार इसलिए भी बना रहा क्योंकि सबसे बड़ी जो चैलेंज होता है यू नो कीपिंग अप विद द टाइम, सबसे बहुत बड़ा चैलेंज होता है कि जो लोग एक चीज को हिट हो जाते हैं तो उसपे फ्लेक्सिबिलिटी नहीं होती है, वो चेंज नहीं होते हैं. तो जितने भी आज की डेट में भी सुपरस्टार हैं वो सुपरस्टार इसलिए अपनी पोजीशन पे बने हुए हैं क्योंकि दे आर एक्सपेरिमेंटिंग विद देयर रूल्स, दे आर कीप ऑन चेंजिंग. सो आई थिंक द बेस्ट पार्ट अबाउट RVCJ वाज यू नो इट केप्ट नोइंग द टेस्ट ऑफ द ऑडियंस एंड वो उस तरह से फ्लेक्सिबिलिटी के साथ चेंज होता गया और आज की डेट में भी यू नो इट इज एज मच एज रिलेटेबल एज इट वॉज बिफोर.
देखिए मेरा आपसे एक सवाल है कि हम बात करते हैं कि टिकटॉक जब बंद हो गया तब बहुत सारे लोग कह रहे थे कि बहुत सारे जो देहात से लोग हैं, कहीं बहुत ऐसी रिमोट जगह से लोग हैं कि जो जिनको प्लेटफॉर्म्स पता नहीं होते हैं, उसका एक्सेस नहीं होता, उसकी नॉलेज नहीं होती है, तो वहां तक पहुंचना वो एक जरिया बन गया था. तो आप का जर्नी शुरू होता है रेडियो से जहाँ पे सिर्फ आपको सुन पा रहे हैं लोग, पता नहीं है कि क्या है. तो उम्र में या फिर ऑडियंस जो सुनती है और ऑडियंस जो यहाँ पे देख रही है, जैसे कि सब सारी ऑडियंस अभी छोटे छोटे बहुत सारे प्लेटफॉर्म्स है जहाँ पे वेब सीरीज बनती है, कुछ अपने मीम मीम के ये बनते हैं, छोटे छोटे जो क्लिपिंग्स बनते हैं, उसका कंजम्पशन बहुत है. तो आपको क्या डिफरेंस लग रहा है कि अभी हम डेमोक्रेटाइजेशन की बात करें कि उस सारे लोगों को कंटेंट बनाना बनाने की सुविधा हो रही है, एक फोन आ गया आपके पास तो आप कंटेंट तो बना ही पा रहे हो, उसके बाद है कि वो कहाँ रखेंगे हम, जिसको कहाँ प्लेस करेंगे, डिस्ट्रीब्यूट कैसे करेंगे. तो आपका एक्सपीरियंस क्या रहा इसमें?
फर्स्ट ऑफ ऑल टिकटॉक से मैं शुरू करना चाहूंगी. मैं मतलब बहुत सारे लोग हैं जो कलेक्टिवली टिकटॉक को बैश करते हैं फॉर द क्रिंज कंटेंट, यू नो वो जो क्रिंज कंटेंट का पायनियर उसे माना जाता है. आई वुड यू नो आई डेफिनेटली वोंट अग्री विद दैट बिकॉज टिकटॉक ने हमें बहुत सारे स्टार्स भी दिए हैं और बहुत सारी क्रिएटिविटी का एक अड्डा रहा है. और देखा जाए तो यू नो छोटे छोटे कॉन्टेंट और छोटी छोटी स्टोरी टेलिंग की शुरुआत वहां से हुई है. कोई भले ही पब्लिकली डिसोन कर दे कि नहीं नहीं हम तो नहीं देखते, लेकिन सबका गिल्टी प्लेजर रहा है टिकटॉक एक के बाद एक वीडियोस देखने का, सबका रहा है जहां तक है. तो कंटेंट क्रिएशन के लिए कोई भी क्लास, कोई भी यू नो मतलब ये किसी भी तरीके से बंधा हुआ नहीं है. सबसे बेस्ट बात यह है कि अगर आपको एक स्टोरी बतानी है दुनिया को, ऑल यू नीड इज योर स्टोरी एंड द कैमरा एंड देयर यू गो. तो क्लास हो कोई भी, इसीलिए हमने इतने अच्छे अच्छे कंटेंट भी यू नो गांव से या बहुत सारे ऐसे स्टेचर के लोगों ने बनाए और हमने अप्रिशिएट भी किया कि क्या डांस मूव है. तो मुझे लगता है दिस इज द पावर ऑफ कंटेंट. द पावर ऑफ कंटेंट इज सो मच बिगर देन एनीथिंग कि बड़े बड़े स्टार्स की भी मूवी नहीं चलती है अगर स्टोरी में दम नहीं होता है. सो इट इज ऑल अबाउट द स्टोरी टेलिंग. तो आज की डेट में सबसे अच्छी बात मुझे ये लगती है कि यू नो छोटी से छोटी स्टोरी पे भी आप ध्यान देते हो. तो इंस्टा स्टोरी हो गई या यू नो व्हाट्सएप स्टोरी हो गई, कुछ ना कुछ कोई ना कोई एक्सप्रेस करके कहना चाह रहा है एंड यू नो द वर्ल्ड इज योर ऑयस्टर. एंड आज की डेट में मुझे लगता है स्टार बनना कंपैरेटिवली बहुत आसान है बिकॉज ऑल यू नीड इज इंटरनेट कैमरा एंड योर स्टोरी. एंड इफ योर स्टोरी हैज दैट पावर, इफ योर कॉन्टेंट हैज दैट पावर, तो फिर आपको कोई रोक नहीं सकता. हमने कितने सारे स्टार्स बनते देखे हैं इस पैंडेमिक में, चाहे वो सलोनी गौड़ हो या उषा कपिला, हमने बहुत सारे ऐसे स्टार्स देखे जो अपने बस घर की चार दीवारी में बैठकर उन्होंने कंटेंट बनाए एंड देन दे इट वेंट वायरल. सो दैट्स द पावर ऑफ द कंटेंट.
नाइस नाइस इंटरेस्टिंग. आई मीन दिस इज अ वेरी आई मीन आई लाइक द डाइवर्सिटी ऑफ दिस डिस्कशन बिकॉज़ वी आर स्पैनिंग फ्रॉम इंडिपेंडेंट सिनेमा टू actually people themselves making content. I would like to turn to Shikha now.
Hi
Shikha. Tell introduce yourself, tell us about the Red Sparrow and the anecdote that we would we heard, but I think our audience deserves it too.
First of all, thank you so much for inviting me on this amazing panel. Like, I'm having so much fun listening to all these stories, and I'm so amazed. And honestly, my journey is different from, you know, from the people that we've heard till now. I like to believe that I am one of those fortunate people jinko bachpan se pata tha ki picture banani hai. Probably I think 2-3 saal ki thi na tab se I think mujhe pata tha ki picture hi banani hai life mein aur kuch nahi karna hai. But having said that, I never really got a chance to go to a film school. I ended up doing finance, financial markets. I ended up doing brand management. I did all of those things, but nothing related to, you know, films or filmmaking. जबकि इतनी क्लैरिटी थी एंड आई एम वन ऑफ दोज पीपल जिनको करना है बट टेक्निकली पता नहीं है कैसे करना है बिकॉज आई हैव नॉट गॉटन अ चांस टू गो टू फिल्म स्कूल और वर्क ऑन अ फिल्म सेट लाइक आई ट्राइड अ लॉट टू गेट इनटू प्रोडक्शन एंड यू नो असिस्टिंग एटसेट्रा एटसेट्रा बट समहाउ इट वाजंट वर्किंग आउट एंड दिस इज अ पीरियड आई थिंक 2 years बैक व्हेन आई डिसाइडेड कि यू नो all of this is going to keep happening but if I have to do this I have to do this and I need to figure a way so I just started randomly talking to people who were in the industry I had one or two friends from college who ended up being actors in the industry and you know doing some remote work or whatever and I started talking to people I started asking them ki kaise hota hai kya hota hai mujhe thoda bata do I need to understand, learn. I would keep reading a lot. I would keep reading filmmaking books. I would, you know, I was just trying to gather a lot of information, absorb everything. And fortunately, during this period, I was talking to a lot of people from the industry who were working there. And I realized ki how much ever I read or try to educate myself, these conversations are just so rich that they need to be out there because I know mere jaise aur bahut sare log hai jinko janna hai but pata nahi kaise kare right not everyone is not everyone has the resources or anything to come to Bombay and just randomly go talk to people so I was like I need to get these conversations bring these conversations in light outside Now, what happens is when you're trying to look at conversations on the internet, etc., the max, the deepest penetration into the filmmaking is director, actors, max producers, you know. You do not find a lot of conversations with the cinematographers or the sound designers or the production designers, the costume people, makeup and hair. Wo abhi कुछ पा जैसी बन गई तो यस यू विल टॉक टू द मेकअप एंड यू नो कॉस्मेटिक डिपार्टमेंट बट नॉट फॉर एवरी फिल्म बट दैट डजंट मीन एवरी फिल्म डजंट इजंट दैट हैवी ऑन दीस टेक्निकल डिपार्टमेंट्स सो आई वाज टॉकिंग टू दीस पीपल एंड आई वांटेड टू गेट दीस कॉन्वर्सेशंस आउट यू नो आउट बिकॉज आई वाज लाइक मेरे जैसे बहुत होंगे मतलब मेरे जैसे लोगों को भी देखने मिल गया ना आई फील वेरी हैप्पी कि आई एम डूइंग समथिंग गुड एंड दैट इज हाउ Red Sparrow was born. That was the, you know, instant idea where Red Sparrow was born. कि यार ये सब बाहर तो लाना ही है, you know. And then it evolved into we started doing offline events because I was like, if I want to get these conversations out to people, I want to give them a chance to interact with the people who they are talking to. So we were doing these offline events where, for example, we did a cinematographers panel we had four cinematographers that was our format where we would have the panel with the people and we would have 150 to 200 people in the audience and after the discussion they would get a chance to interact you know ask direct questions and most of the audiences were aspiring cinematographers if we have a writers panel most of these audiences are aspiring writers aspiring filmmakers so they get a chance to interact directly with these people but again due to covid hum march tak ye hamari hamari offline panels chal rahe the and then covid like Prateek said covid ho gaya and we were forced to you know put like get these conversations online and then I realized ki oh my god agar covid nahi hota I would have probably never stumbled upon how great this avenue is digital on YouTube, because again, the reach is much wider, you know, and the convenience of it. Agar aaj nahi dekhna hai to main 10 din baad dekh sakta hu. Convenience of it. And so that's how my digital journey started. My digital journey honestly only started now in COVID. I have been Red Sparrow is 2 years old now, and we've been doing offline events all through that one.
So I would like to interrupt. Tell us about how you stumbled upon the name.
So my nickname means Sparrow in Marathi, and I was very clear that I wanted to have Sparrow in the brand name. So that's how.
And how did you gather your team, or who are your colleagues, and how do you work together?
So in the beginning, I think it's with every entrepreneur, you just try and find believers, you just try and find people jinko samajh aata hai aap kya karne ki koshish kar rahe ho, and they would like to align themselves with you in the long journey, because starting mein kahan paise hote hai na itne sare that you go on hiring the best people in the world, you can't really do that. So I did the same thing, I had the same approach, I tried and I tried to find believers that would believe in my vision, or you know, that would align with the vision of the Red Sparrow and that would want to contribute to what we're trying to build. And of course, kuch wrong choices bhi hue hain, kuch bahut amazing choices hue hain. There are right now we're a team of about 10 people. And there are 3 to 4 people in the team just starting se lekar abhi tak hai. So you know, you just find, you can't go on and say ki mujhe to best social media marketing person hi chahiye. You can't go and say that. You can't define it only. A person who is the best social media person for me might not be for you, or might not be for Gaurav or for Prateek.
I totally agree to this point that it's more like a tree which you grow, and everybody grows together. It's never something that you buy from nursery. It's a seed that you grow.
Even today, if someone new is joining our team, I'm honestly saying this. I always say ki, you know, we work like a family together. Everyone is talking to everyone. Everyone is contributing. Everyone is, you know, guiding everyone else. It's literally like bunch of 10 people coming together and working for something they love. It's literally, that's the culture, and I would want to maintain that forever.
Do you see your platform as a platform for filmmaking, and not just learning about cinema and the curious? I think it's more to do with the curiosity right now, and is it going into a making space where it's more democratizing, so to say?
So, like I said, at bachpan se, I wanted to be a filmmaker, right? So eventually, I would love to, you know, make films once this journey I have sort of. We are going in that direction. Having said that, Red Sparrow will not be an entity that will make films. I also have a sister company that is called Red Carbon Films, and we've already produced a few films. I'm a producer on those films. And in fact, my first film last year was a winner at MAMI, and it was widely celebrated, etc.
Okay, congrats.
So, but it will not be a Red Sparrow, because Red Sparrow will always remain a place to learn, to absorb, to, you know, exchange information, for conversations, for everything, just to basically dig deep into the world of cinema. Red Sparrow will always be that. But yes, it will support the making, it will support everything that happens in the world of cinema.
Yeah, I really appreciate your efforts and trying to bring this knowledge and nuance to a lot of people who are curious or who are filmmakers themselves. And like you said, there are many such expert professions which we never actually get to interact with, like makeup dadas hai, colorists hai, ADs hai, jinse कभी बात नहीं हो पाती कि उनका काम क्या है.
कॉस्ट्यूम इज एक्सट्रीमली costume is one of the departments that is really never spoken about, but it just adds so much because it's right in your face.
Correct.
In every frame that you watch,
correct.
But you never really consciously acknowledge it ki kitna sahi costume pehnaya hai is character ya isko. It adds so much to the character, to the scene, to everything, but it's never really acknowledged. So there are so many departments like that you just go unnoticed, and people who aspire to be in that department or that aspect of filmmaking can I just feel like there is a gap that probably needs to be bridged. Or
you're bridging it nice. And with now Thank it's you. Being digital, it's so interesting that you're being able to reach out to more and more people. Thank you. And I would now move to Nachi. Hello, how are you?
I'm good.
You've been quite a listener today. Now it's time for you to speak. Time for you to speak and tell us about yourself, and Potato Eaters as a initiative. How did you perceive and started it?
Okay, so. Basically, I'm myself a filmmaker. So I graduated from Film and Television Institute of India, Pune, direction. So it's been a couple of years. So I've been working in, I'm a Tamil by origin. So I work in Chennai now. So I've been working for a couple of years as assistant director in the industry. So I've been also writing my own stuff. And then this COVID happened, the shoot stopped. So for a month or two, we were in home, and I was myself going mad, not being able, because I'm also a person, Pratik told, I'm somebody who I use a lot of online stuff otherwise, but I would like to go meet people, because in the institute we have been brought up like that also, it's always
I know
yeah. So in that sense, then it was, not going to a tea shop in a day is something I'm missing something out of the day, but that was all stopped. But again, somewhere, even before FTI and when I decided filmmaking, in my school days, I was doing drama and stuff. So me and my friend, when we are going, I come from a very small village. So when we used to drive, it's also near to Western Ghats. So when we used to drive in the Ghat roads and other things, we used to feel that we should have a kind of a commune space where people like-minded can get together, work, live there, watch films, work, do everything. It's kind of a very idealistic, utopian thing which we used to think. This was when we were younger, days or even before that. So then that was there always in my back of my mind that I need to have a community here to support whatever I do. So that is the spark, if I would say. So I'm a filmmaker myself. And so why Potato Eaters? Potato Eaters, the name, it just happened because I'm a very big fan of Van Gogh. Painter. So then that painting, then the politics behind it, because potato is the only food for most of the people, working class people, that gives them the. Aajkal to Parle Ji hai, a lot of other things have come, which can actually be a meat is there, but whenever other things are not available, so potatoes becomes a very important element of working class. So that was the idea. That's how it started, Potato Eaters Collective. But unlike others, I would not call myself an entrepreneur or our organization, because we always never wanted to be an institution or an organization. We
right.
never wanted to be or an NGO for that matter. So we wanted to be unbound.
Like a community.
Like community. And also for us, cinema obviously we all love cinema. I'm filming myself, but cinema is not so important. Other even if cinema is dead tomorrow, nobody's going to, obviously people who are engaged in the work, we'll have to find some other work. But otherwise, this is such an essential commodity like medicine or other things. But again, in COVID, I realized that it can actually be an essential commodity, especially in times of crisis like this. Because if not for Netflix, I think many people would have gone literally crazy. Like if not for Netflix or any other platform. So in that way, it's a big support system, not just as an entertainment, but as a friend. Cinema can actually be a uniting force also. Definitely, it's the most important art form, no doubt about it. I think the most democratic in itself. Like digital or analog, cinema is the first time I think people from all caste and class could sit in the same hall and watch something. I think never before in the history that had happened. Be it be Carnatic concerts or whatever, there was always a class difference. And also, I am completely with Nidhi. I'm a great lover of TikTok. I don't have that class difference at all with TikTok. And because a lot of cinema, what we see is worse than TikTok in that matter, if you want to compare the class of it. I think it's a very classist thing also.
Correct.
The attack on TikTok and like other things. See,
so that's where we are getting at, because what happens is then there is curation, then there is a class, and then there is no democracy. There is no say for a lot of people who come from a different background. See, there is a, in the name of quality, we censor the whole whole being of a lot of people.
That's what I'm telling you. See, always democracy, as we understand, we also think that in a very liberal sense, democracy is something which will allow everything. That can't happen. Then it will be a chaos in society. Right. Obviously, there will be whomever is, for that matter, the ruling class or whomever is the deciding person there. For instance, even if you, me, even potato eaters or white wall, or we are deciding. When we are, like, when we say we keep a camera, we start manipulating. Whether we tell that, no, I don't manipulate, I do cinema which is organic and like all that is nonsense to me.
Yeah.
Whenever you put a camera, you're intruding in somebody's life. The same way, whenever you choose a film, whenever you're curating something, your politics is there, right there. So your choice of the film, whom you invite for the talk, what do you talk, how do you talk, which language you use, everything is coming from the person, you under your organization stands for. So in that matter, obviously, we as an organization, we would actually call ourselves as an organization. Maybe now, how much ever we try, but there needs to be an institutionalization for some kind of activity. So we're not registered it as anything as such. But we then started with Kumar Sahni's talk. That was KK Margin's birth anniversary. Then started like that. Then John Abraham's birthday fall. The spark is very simple for me. Like when you type John Abraham, it's the actor John Abraham which will come.
Yeah, obviously.
The Google. So I thought these things should change. Like the
correct.
It's very simple according to me how things started. So we are evolving. Obviously, we'll get.
I have two questions for you. One is obviously related to your education. Like as a filmmaker, you have been dean to FTII, and I've been for one orientation, and I didn't attempt again in 2011. But I've been part of a lot of projects, and I've been working in the institute for a very long time. Like there are a lot of friends who have studied in there. But institute, the FTII, because it's the prime institute of India and it is the government who runs it, does it democratize cinema according to you, and does it prepare you for digital?
See, like
we have to be a little fast because we have very less time.
That's what I'm telling. If you're going to a medical school, like they prepare you to be a doctor.
Correct.
right? They don't prepare you to be a doctor in a private college, a private hospital, a government hospital. The same goes in a film school. See, the basics are same. This digital analog, these are tools. At the end of the day, we are making cinema. Like, we're trying to touch lives. That's all. I don't see... another thing is that, see, the digital democracy, all that when we speak, it is still the privileged lot. I need to have a computer, no? I need to have a internet for me to sit and watch even YouTube. So there are villages in the country where they don't even have electricity. And people, when they want to download their hall tickets, there are stories you have heard that people have to go like 10, 15 kilometers just to get a internet, this thing. So all these HD, 2K, all these are like nowhere accessible to them.
Correct.
So in that way, I'm also completely against this idea that, oh, whatever is coming in the theater is all nonsense, and like Bollywood is nonsense, mainstream cinema is nonsense.
No, obviously, we are not here to make such blanket statements. Definitely not.
That's also not a thing. And I also don't want to project ourselves as saviors of cinema. Cinema will sustain by itself. We don't need to. We actually are getting something out of cinema. So that's right. Why we are interested. It's not that we are doing some service to the this thing. It's part of our work.
And last thing I wanted to ask you, what are the activities of Potato Eater?
See, yeah, like Red Sparrow, we have been also doing some kind of pedagogical activities, which you say, but trying to reach to the people who are not privileged enough to go to a film school or access certain kind of stuff. Earlier, we started with online sessions, like calling a panel. Yeah, Kumar Sani was there, Veena Paul. And we wanted to completely get out of that. I even wanted to take names, but there are these fancy shows, they'll just sit and gossip. Our idea is not to sit and gossip about which actor was wearing what pant. Our idea was to engage in real academia. So that was the idea. Then we started curating some films. Earlier it was all like stuff which didn't have to deal with any kind of arrangement with the makers, but then Munshi Lal was something which was very interesting, which happened. Like, that's something, a breaking point. So after that, now we are actually curating some other films also. But slowly, slowly, we are also getting other activities which will be like in Tamil. Like, mostly we are going to concentrate on Tamil Nadu now, like maybe taking cinema to little more places which is not accessible, getting the workshops done there.
Okay. So yeah, it's a question for you, Gaurav. I think you are the best one to answer this. Should content creator follow what's the trending, which is whatever is trending, or they should do what's authentic and true to themselves? How do you choose content? What is the way of curation?
I think personally, you know, it's like, again, going for a blanket statement. I think to each his own, because, the great part about so many formats and platforms and TikToks and, you know, Facebook is that every person has a voice, every person has a need to express. And I think these platforms allow us to do that. So I think everyone chooses what they want to do, whether you want to follow what's the fad, what is the trend, or you have your own unique point of view. So I think it should be to each person.
What do you think, Nidhi?
That's what Nidhi would also agree, right?
Yeah, I definitely agree with you, Gaurav. And also, I just want to add ki mujhe lagta hai ki aapka ye sawal tha na ki follow karna chahiye wo jo trend hai ya nahi. Ya matlab, dekhiye har ek creator ki na ek set of audience hoti hai. Ye to hame matlab this is like the very foremost rule ki हर एक परफॉर्मर और क्रिएटर जो भी है उसकी एक अपनी एक ऑडियंस है तो जो उसके बनाए कंटेंट को देखती है लगातार. लेकिन सोशल मीडिया के आ जाने से जो हैशटैग चीजें चल रही हैं, कुछ भी जो भी चल रहा है, फॉर एग्जांपल विनोद इज सच एन इररिलेवेंट थिंग बट इट गॉट वायरल एंड कॉन्टेंट क्रिएटर यू नो फ्रॉम एवरीवेयर स्टार्टेड मेकिंग कॉन्टेंट ऑन विनोद एंड पीपल इवन वॉच्ड इट. So I think if you can cash it in any way possible, I think that's a good thing. Na? It is working in your favor. Whatever is trending, you can also grab new audience. Ki, arre wah, Vinod pe isne sabse acha video banaya. Let's watch her video. So I think that is beneficial. If it is working for you, I think why not?
और भी एक सवाल है कि अब आप तो ट्रेंड पे सवार हो रहे हो, बट क्या इसका आप बाकी के अच्छी चीजों के लिए भी फायदा उठा सकते हो? बट विनोद तो मतलब बेतुकी चीज है एक तो, पर उसकी उससे मतलब निकाल के अच्छा कुछ बन सकता है क्या? उसके इसकी उसकी कोशिश कैसे की जाए?
मैं वही कह रही हूँ कि हर किसी क्रिएटर का एक अलग टेक होता है किसी भी चीज पे. फॉर एग्जाम्पल, नेहा कक्कड़ की अभी शादी हुई, उस पे हजारों कंटेंट क्रिएटर्स ने हजारों कंटेंट बनाए, किसी ने पॉजिटिवली, किसी ने नेगेटिवली. तो वो आप पे डिपेंड करता है कि आपकी ऑडियंस, जैसे कि मैंने कहा कि हर किसी की एक ऑडियंस है. जैसे एक क्राउड होता है जिसको सिर्फ सोफिस्टिकेटेड चीजें केटर कर रहा है वो क्रिएटर, तो अगर वो वहां एक्सपेरिमेंट करता है, यू नो, ऐसा नहीं है कि वो बैकफायर ही करेगा, बट सब कोई अपने अपने ऑडियंस के हिसाब से, क्रिएटर और ऑडियंस, मतलब ये सिनेमा और ऑडियंस की तरह है कि अगर कोई मान लो हॉरर फिल्म आई है, अगर आप नहीं देखते तो आप नहीं देखेंगे, पर अगर आप देखते वो वाली ऑडियंस है कि देख भी सकते हैं, तो यू नो यू कैन बी अ फैन ऑफ दैट मूवी. आप जा रहे हो, आप देख रहे हो और आप यू नो हॉल से निकले कि यार ये तो अच्छी निकली. यू नो दिस इज एग्जैक्टली लाइक दैट, कि आपको कॉन्टेंट बनाना है लेकिन ऑडियंस का ख्याल भी रखना है, कॉन्टेंट का भी ख्याल रखना है. पर मुझे लगता है मी बीइंग यू नो पर्सनली मैं कंटेंट का ज्यादा ख्याल रखती हूँ कंपेयर टू माय ऑडियंस, क्योंकि मुझे लगता है कि ऑडियंस प्लीज करने को मैं अगर गई तो फिर बहुत ही खराब हो जाएगा. तो ऑडियंस प्लीजिंग में नहीं फंसना है, अपने को सिर्फ अच्छा कंटेंट बनाना है जो आपका कॉन्शियस अलाउ कर रहा है, जो आपका क्रिएटिविटी साइड अलाउ कर रहा है. आई थिंक यू शुड डू इट.
प्रतीक, यू आर इन अ वे, इफ यू आर क्रिएटिंग एनी कंटेंट, इट इज कॉम्प्रिहेंसिव कंटेंट और pedagogical content or something which is educative and interactive, but you are still in competition with someone. Like there are big people all the time who are pushing you away. How do you stay relevant and still produce what you produce?
See, again,
and also like in your case, present what you present.
Okay, so what, every content, everything that you make has its audience, whether it's a wide audience or whether it's a niche, right? Everything has an audience. So it's just that you just need to know who your audience is, hai na? Phir content banana bahut aasan ho jayega. Aur main is tarah kaam karta hu, jab khaaskar because I make films also. I try to identify and resonate with the script, whether I'm working as a filmmaker or as an actor. If I get that, then rest will follow. I have, I was just telling somebody today, I have a very single track approach. When I'm writing something, then I'm not thinking about how am I going to execute it. Sorry. When I'm executing something, I'm not thinking about how am I going to distribute it. Once it is made, then I'm only going to think about how to distribute it and not right. go back right. to it, yaar ye change kar do, wo change kar do, yahan pe ek frame kaat deta hu. Wo, there's a tendency that you might get stuck in the loop. So I try to simplify it as much as possible and, don't need to think too much about, agar main short film screen kar raha hu, to agar wo content achha hai na, to mujhe sochne ki zarurat nahi ki audience kaise aayegi, audience aa jayegi.
My another question that is very specific to Gaurav, what is the procedure and legalities and challenge, like that sort of a rules and regulation challenges that you might have to face?
Can you be a little more specific? I think,
like, for example, what is the prerequisite for a film to have shown on OTT?
Right. So, we have so many creators. Suppose, when Shikha makes a feature film, and suppose Shikha has made it, say, on a modest budget and not as with, say, Ayushman or a Rajkumar, but she's got a lot of creators, say, from her fraternity. Now, I think what we need to see is that if the film doesn't succeed in the mainstream bracket and is more in the independent space, I think what we look at is that there is an audience who wants to watch the film, and the filmmaker knows where this audience is. That's what we are talking about. So I think most important is that it should be an unreleased film which hasn't been on a platform. So how, when we release on a theater, you do not have a film being shown either digitally or through satellite. You know, you allow your people the first viewing opportunity in a theater. Similarly, on cinema, or if you want to release, you allow your film, you know, for the first time. So I think that is one of the thing. And obviously, there are lots and lots of things, you know, in terms of the nitty gritties, in terms of the agreement.
Formalities.
But majorly, I think what we feel is that the independent creators know who their audience would be. They have an understanding of what community would want to watch the film. And the good thing is that with power of technology, you can reach out to anybody across the world, right? So if you wanted to do a theatrical, you know, you would want to pick up all traditional means of marketing and then do a whole P&A and then book the theaters and then wait for people to come in. With digital, you have an online theater and you just need to ensure with digital tools and technology that your audience gets to know about your film. And then, you know, as we say, the audience is the person who can decide whether a content is good, bad, weird. If millions of people have seen TikTok videos, there would be some merit there, right? That they are consuming it. So I think we don't define personally as a platform like what's good, bad. I think the audience can easily tell you. And that's where the answer lies, basically.
So I have a question for Gaurav, if that's okay. It's just like, so some ex-persons made a film and they just directly approach you and say, this is my independent film or guerrilla film that I've made. And you can put it on your website and you take this share and I take this share. And that's just like, there's no further complications to that, right?
What do you like? I didn't understand with the complication. So I'll give you an example, Shanmukh. Basically, so when you associate with any OTT or any platform or theater platform, the content creator meets the platform. They do an agreement or a, you know, collaboration together, and they understand how the revenue will split. And then both of them try to reach to the community and ensure that the campaign is successful, right? So yes, so that's the whole idea, that now you have a way through which, through the technology, you can host your film on a certain platform and you can reach out to the audiences and you earn like a high revenue share on every ticket which is sold on the platform.
Yeah, that's wonderful. And the final product of the filmmaker will be the final product, and it's not like in another OTT platform where you're asked to tint the color a little or do anything else. I will give you a final product and you'll be putting it on your site, and we will definitely be going ahead and promoting it in the community that we are in, right?
Yeah, exactly. So I think we understand the freedom of filmmakers, and I mean we'll definitely not force filmmakers on those formula or mainstream based adjustments.
Yeah, because the subscription model works like that. It needs a certain standardization, and that's why the makers are bent to their will. Instead, here you have more open platform where you could it's more for you than the presenter itself.
Can I add something from because I've been on the maker side of it, right? So when we made our first film and it was a winner at Mami, etc. So it got popular because of that, right? And then we went on, now we are on Large Cut Films on YouTube, the channel that is on YouTube, Large Cut Films, right? We are on Large Cut Films and we are on subscription based 2-3 platforms as well. And now we're going into bigger platforms. I can't take names, but one of the bigger platforms, our short is also going there. But they haven't really asked us to change anything, even though it's subscription based, even though it's a huge brand, even though they have to meet their certain. I think they work backwards. That is what I feel. They work backwards on pre-created content. They choose, does this fit? Does this already made thing fit in our universe? Then they pick it. if it doesn't, they don't get into the ye change karo, wo change karo, and they just don't pick it. As simple as that. If they are making it by themselves, they are commissioning content, of course they have a say because they're the producers. So of course they have a say and they will get into the creative side of it, etc. But when it's pre-made content, I don't really think they get into those. They just put in brackets. Ye hamare liye chal raha hai, le lo. Ye hamare liye nahi chal raha hai. So I think putting a black and white in that way. Again, this is my personal. I'm sure different people would have different experiences. And
For example, like Netflix has very specifications from like what cameras that are allowed.
That is when it's in the making. That is when.
No, I don't think so. Even for the acquisition, they have certain standards. They would not accept.
But if it's a pre-made film, like for example, Court was a film already made. Now Netflix can't go back and say ki ab aap ye camera ke saath wapas se shoot karo, right?
So they don't
pick it up. Only when Netflix or any platform or any production house or only then they are involved in the making stage of it. It doesn't happen after the film is made and they are acquiring it. It just doesn't make sense. It wouldn't work for any of the platforms.
That's actually the ideal world, but what's happening around is they would have to fit to certain requirements of how are the shows on Netflix, sir. So they ask you to change little bits, which may be annoying at times, but that's just how it is. But if it is an already big film or a Mami winning film, it wouldn't happen to that cause they would really like to acquire it. But if it's another indie film and that's not hugely popular, then if you are the primary person who wants that to be on a particular OTT platform, then you might be asked to change those little bits or whatever. So, yeah.
Thank you, Shanmok, for being another panelist on our platform. I have a last question to Nachi. What do you expect? So, as you are a filmmaker and you have walked in many shoes, and you come from a very different background. Like, you don't come from a regular Mumbai grown up who has this access, very easy access. You also come from a language which is not so to say Bollywood language. And what do you expect from OTT platforms? What are the expectations? And I think this would be the end of our discussion.
As we all know, there is a standardization. We can't disagree with
correct.
For instance, there is a joke we used to tell. Agar film, if it is shot in India or any other third world, just put a Mexican filter. येलो कलर का एक फिल्टर आता
है
और इट इज अ पीएन फिल्म उसमें भी येलो डाल दो
सो और ब्लैक डाल दो
दीस आर सर्टेन आई थिंक एक्चुअली व्हाट हैड हैपेंड इज द स्टैंडर्डाइजेशन इज हैपनिंग बिकॉज़ देयर आर दिस बिग प्लेयर्स लाइक Amazon और Netflix दे हैव अ लाइक इवन इन थिएटर्स आल्सो इफ यू सी देयर इज अ स्टैंडर्डाइजेशन
करेक्ट
लाइक हाउ मच व्हाटएवर एस्पेक्ट रेशियो यू शूट द फिल्म दे विल क्रॉप इट टू अ सर्टेन साइज फॉर द बिकॉज़ the visual memory of people, the culture has become, they've changed to certain things to adapt to that. So that is how a capitalist economy works. It's always market driven. So what I expect of OTT is that it's all great to have GOT and like even Scam 92 was great. Everything is of that kind, which is of more,
colossal, massive
thriller and like other genre. Yeah, they become a genre thing. But if OTT can also become a platform where one end is independent cinema and like all these things coming is fine. But other than this thing should become little more vibrant, the content side. So now what is happening is okay, like everybody is getting a chance, but again the content is a certain kind. I'm telling about a bigger place like Amazon.
Right.
There is a certain kind of content they will like. So if that has to change, I think it's then it can become a really, really the word democracy might be a very suitable thing. And also this subscription thing is a nonsense for me. Like, it should be all, see, first of all, people are paying for internet. Like, say, like, so the subscription again, and like, because what happens in a subscription is again, like, you know, you're bombarded with other things. So it's like going to a supermarket where you'll end up buying stuff which you really don't want in your life. So that's how the market works. So the subscription and other things, if they can little bit ease out and become something like very simple, like YouTube, where people can just go and watch. Obviously, filmmakers should get something out of it. I myself in the business of making films.
Correct.
That we can figure out.
But it has to be sustainable.
Yeah,
but I think Gaurav and Pratik are working in these spaces to actually make it happen.
So we are also working in that direction only. Yeah, like where we have our own system somehow, maybe in the future.
So it was really nice talking to you all. A lot of new things came up and perspectives were shared. I'm really thankful for putting up this, Ankit. Thank you for putting up this diverse panel. And thank you, everybody.
Yeah.
Thank you so much.
Thanks a lot.
Thank you.